Good evening, students. I hope I am audible and visible to all of you. Before I begin, a very happy Ugadi to all of you. Ugadi Subhakankshalu. Mee andariki New Year baa galustavalani korukuntunna. Now, today we are basically going to discuss, we have already shared two questions that I'm going to discuss. Last week, I have given you all a commitment where I said that I'm going to discuss questions regularly from here on with you all. So keeping that commitment now, I have decided that I'm going to discuss mains related questions, different subjects. This week I have scheduled two questions that I wanted to discuss. One is on polity, the other is on formation. Very quickly, I'll tell you the context of the question, how to write, what should be the structure, and how do you put it in that limited words. The first question that I gave was, India is federal in spirit and unitary in federal in form and unitary in spirit. Comment. This is basically related to the center-state relations in India. Federalism is about having more than one government. Federalism means decentralized government. So we are talking about decentralized rule. India has decentralized rule. We have two governments, one at the center, the other is at the states. What kind of relationship we have between the center and states is about Indian federalism. Now, when I say India is federal in form, but unitary in spirit, the meaning of this is when I look at India, I understand that there are two governments. I look at India, I find a central government, I find a state government. But when I look at the working of the government in the country, I understand that India the Indian constitution has given more power to the center when compared to the states. This constitution of India did not create weak states. It created strong states, but it gave more powers. It created a stronger center. How is it that India is a federation, but also a federation with strong center is what you have to write in this answer. So for this, we are saying comment. When we are using the word comment, you are supposed to give your opinion. So we begin the answer by telling that India is federal in form because the Indian constitution provides for two levels of government. In fact, it provides for three levels of government, but we basically talk about the center and the state first. So it provides for two levels of government, one at the center and the other in the states. However, see, having central and state government is a feature of federation. But within central and state government, what we have, the problem we have right now is the existence of states in India, whether you will continue to remain a state or not in India, will be decided by parliament. For example, AP reorganization bill was not approved by the AP assembly. Despite that, the government went ahead, the central government went ahead and created Telangana. Likewise, UP, the assembly requested parliament to divide it into four states when Mayawati ji was the chief minister. But the center did not adhere to it. The center decided against dividing UP. So finally, will you remain a state or not is in the hands of the center. That is federation with a strong center. The center decides your size, your shape, and your name. The size, shape, and name of the state. Okay, so that is one point that we have to write. The second point is, though Indian constitution provides for central government and state government, office of governor, governor is the head of the country, head of the state. Office of the governor is in the control of the center because governor is an appointed post. It is not an elected post. It is an appointed post. In extreme situations, in situations of an emergency, the governor will actually function as an agent of the center. So, you know, the center has control over you as a state because your head is in their control. Now, these are two features of federation with a strong center. The second point that we talk about whenever we talk about federation is there should be division of powers between the center and the state. And this division of powers happens in the form of the three lists, the union list, the state list, and the concurrent list. In India also, we have division of powers between the center and state in the form of union list, state list, and concurrent list. Then where is the problem? The problem lies in the fact that center has many subjects, much more than the state. Usually in a federation, center will have less number of subjects and states will have more number of subjects. In India, it is the other way around. Center has more number of subjects under its control. State has less number of subjects. That is the first problem. The second problem is whenever there is a conflict between center-made law and state-made law, central law will prevail over state law. The third problem is the state list is not exclusive to the state. In certain situations, the center can also legislate on the state list. The same is not applicable to the states, meaning under any given circumstances, the state cannot touch the subjects that are listed in the union list. So, you know, union list is exclusive to this center, but state list is not exclusive to the states. And the fourth point is there is every possibility that certain subjects are not listed in any of the three lists, the union list, the state list, and the concurrent list. When certain subjects are not listed in any of the three lists, these subjects are called as residuary subjects, leftover subjects, basically. These are not included anywhere. Okay, they're not included in any of the three lists. These subjects in a federation should usually be given to the states, but in India, it is actually given to the center. So these are the problems within division of powers. So division of powers will be a feature of federation with a strong center. Division of powers is a feature of federation. Now the problems that I highlighted, center has more subjects, center residuary powers are given to the center, center can legislate on state list under certain situations, and in case of a conflict, central law will prevail. These are features of federation with a strong center. Okay, now apart from this, this is the second point. The third point is whenever we say federation, we should have a rigid constitution. Indian constitution no doubt is rigid, but at the same time, Indian constitution is flexible. The flexible aspect of Indian constitution, the flexible nature of Indian constitution is a feature of federation with a strong center. Now, apart from this, another feature that we have in India is, see, whenever we talk about federation, the central parliament should have bicameral legislation, meaning they should have two houses. One is the Lok Sabha, the other is the Rajya Sabha. You should have two houses. But in India, we do have two houses, but when we compare the powers of the two houses, Rajya Sabha has lesser powers than the Lok Sabha. And the other issue is, in a federation, states should be treated equally. You should treat all states equally. But unfortunately, in India, all states are not treated equally. The representation of states in Rajya Sabha will depend on their population. So unequal treatment of states is called as asymmetric federation. And India has asymmetric federation because we do not treat states equally. Okay, and the last point is, see, India should have supremacy. Whenever we say federation, there should be supremacy of constitution. India does have supremacy of constitution, but again, any amendment to the constitution can be done only by the parliament, and India, unlike other federations, does not have dual constitution, two constitutions. It has only one constitution, single constitution. And finally, when it comes to judiciary, when you talk about a federation, judiciary should be independent. But when you talk about federation with a strong center, judiciary is usually integrated. In India, we have both independent as well as integrated judiciary. So you have to write all these points, and towards the end, you have, in the conclusion, you have to give your comment. The comment should be that, you know, India is federal in form, but unitary in spirit, because center, India has created strong states, but a stronger center. The reason for doing this is diversity of the country. If the center is not strong, we are a holding together federation. We are not coming together federation. If the center is not strong, then there is every chance that the states will disintegrate from the union. We cannot allow this disintegration to happen. Therefore, the founding fathers of our country, the constitutional makers, decided that India should have a very, very strong center. So this is the reason. In your comment towards the conclusion, you should write this as a reason. So this is about federation with a strong center. I just hope you are able to, you are actually able to follow what I'm saying. I don't intend to be a very fast, but you know, this is a medium where I cannot use a board. And if I slow down, you might lose input. Trying my level best to make it easy for you to follow. So a quick recap of whatever I've said. I told you that we have discussed one question, that is, India is federal in form but unitary in spirit comment, for which I said in the introduction you should say that India is federal, after which you should write about what are the federal features of Indian constitution and what are the unitary features within it. And after that, in the conclusion, you should say that India is a holding together federation. The word federal has been like pointed out by one of your friends, Anand. The word federation is not mentioned in the constitution. It is deliberately avoided because they did not want India to be a federation. And it makes total sense because, you know, we were always a country first. States came later. So we are not a federation that came together. We are a federation that should be held together. To hold India as a federation together, you need a strong center. So this is about the first question. Now, the second question that I picked up for today was a very simple question. I'm going to make the questions a little complex eventually as we move forward. And I'm also going to ensure that different subjects are discussed for you in these sessions so that you have an idea as to how questions will be asked. The second question I picked up is on the formation of Telangana, which is a 150 marks paper for y'all. And in formation of Telangana, the basic question that I picked up, it is a very simple question. The question is write a detailed note on the 1952 agitation, 1952 agitation or the Mulki agitation that took place before Telangana was integrated into Indian with Andhra Pradesh. We had an agitation, that is the 1952 agitation. Now, write a detailed note on the 1952 agitation for 10 marks. The beauty of this agitation is it is a very small agitation. Yeah, it starts somewhere in July and everything comes to an end in September. So the agitation lasted only for 3 to 4 months, but it was a very successful agitation because whatever demands were laid by the students in the agitation were fulfilled to a large extent. Now, when they say that write a detailed note on the 1952 agitation, it's an open-ended question. So what are you going to detail in that is your choice. You have to decide what you're going to detail in that. You can detail anything. Okay, my suggestion would be you have to go in a sequential order where you talk about the causes of the agitation, the course of the agitation, the outcome of the agitation. So these three things should be there in your answer. To begin with, 1952 agitation took place in Hyderabad state. The most important reason for the agitation was the employment and education related Mulki, non-Mulki issue. But what triggered the agitation was, see, the logic here is simple. We are actually under self-rule because we are still Hyderabad state. We are not integrated with Andhra. The CM is from Hyderabad state. But there was so much of domination of the non-Mulkis in the government that our own people, the Mulkis, were suffering in employment and in education. A classic example of this is what happened in Warangal. In Warangal, about 180 teachers, local teachers who belong to the Telangana region were transferred to rural places, you know, to backward places. And in their places, non-Mulkis were posted. This became a major issue. The students reacted to this and the district educational officer then Partha Saradhi was responsible for it. While this issue was going on, there was a very good teacher in the Hanumakonda Higher Secondary School. And this teacher passed away because of the pressure that was exerted by Partha Saradhi. His passing away was a turnaround for the entire movement because that was when the students decided that they have to come forward and start the agitation. So 1952 agitation basically was started by students in Warangal because of the transfer of Mulki teachers and posting of non-Mulki teachers in their place. Okay. Now the students decided to start agitation. So what they did is they first formed a group and they identified who will be the leader of the group. So they first formed the student action committee, selected their leader. Then they went and met the chief minister and told him that these are our demands. This is what we want. We basically want two things. One is we want a cabinet subcommittee to be appointed to review the Mulki rules. And second is wherever non-Mulkis have occupied the posts of the Mulkis, they should be sent back. These were the two demands. The CM assures them of action, but he does not act. Then the students decide, again the CM comes to Warangal. The students go meet him, remind him about their demands. The CM again assures them action, but he does not. And finally, the students decide that there should be a deadline. They give a deadline to the CM and they say that if you don't act within this deadline, then we will start the agitation. Now, what happens is the evening before the deadline, the eve before the deadline, the CM informs the Warangal collector that he is willing to act on it. Okay, and he says that he's appointing a cabinet subcommittee. The next day, the agitation does not start. Students will be standing outside a school in Hanumakonda and discussing the whole issue. Thinking, anticipating trouble, the collector and the SP of Warangal barge into the school. And these people retaliate. The students retaliate saying that, you know, police, we don't want police to enter into our campus. This leads to a friction and there is a lathi charge. This lathi charge triggers the agitation. This lathi charge leads to students protesting across different centers, you know, educational centers across the Hyderabad state against against the posting of the non-mulkis, and also they will start. You have to write the deadline that they have given Raj, the day when they start the agitation, the day when this Hanumakonda lathi charge happens. You have to write that day. Date, I'll tell you the dates, specific dates that you have to write. These two dates you have to write. You have to also write the name of the leader of the student union, the name of the district educational officer who was in the midst of the controversy, Parth Saradi, the name of the teacher, Rashid, who died because of the pressure exerted by the DEO. These facts you have to add. Now, what happens is after this, the students start agitating. The agitation gradually spreads to Hyderabad and it intensifies by the day. Now, in Hyderabad, the police commissioner Shivraj says that if you agitate, please do not agitate, but if you agitate, there will be serious consequences. He tells the students this. This is public announcement made. Now, the students meet on a particular day, on September 3rd. They meet in City College to discuss about the agitation. And they come to know about the restrictory orders, the prohibitory orders issued by the police commissioner of Hyderabad. Because of the prohibitory orders, they get agitated and they say that we are going to take out a rally right now and protest the prohibitory orders. The prohibitory orders are against rallies and meetings. Many local leaders, including Konda Lakshman Bapuji, try to convince them and tell them not to start the rally. But the students do not listen. By afternoon, the students come out in a rally. Now, what happens is City College is located. I'm sure you guys know about it. City College is located in a place which is a center for all markets. It is very close to Begum Bazaar and all these places. So you have a lot of civilians also moving around the City College. Now, when these students came out as a rally, the civilians also became a part of the rally, and the rally size grew. Police came for lathi charge, and this led to a friction between the students and the police, where the students hurt the police commissioner. And in retaliation, the police opened firing. And this firing led to the death of two people. Okay, two, and next day another two people died. So City College incident is considered as the most bloodshed incident in the 1952 agitation, and it was a turning point because after the City College incident, the government takes very quick measures. What happens is after the City College incident, the next day, the students go to Usmania Hospital for the bodies of the dead. But without the knowledge of the chief minister, the bureaucrats take the bodies of the dead and bury them without giving it to the families. This becomes another major issue and another round of police firing where two more people died. This point is very important because this point clearly indicated that in our own state, we were dominated by the non-mulkis. Even the CM was not aware of the developments. And this was actually raised as an objection when there was a proposal for Vishalandra. Telangana people were against Vishalandra because they feared that there will be too much of domination of non-mulkis if Vishalandra was formed. And a classic example that they gave is this incident post the City College incident. Now, what happened is from the government side, it immediately got into damage control. It appointed a subcommittee. The appointment of the subcommittee was publicly announced. Then they appointed Justice Pingali Jayachandra Reddy's committee. The committee was basically to investigate into City College incident, where the how did this incident happen? What are the reasons? What were the police wrong? What should have been the general approach towards such a movement? Why is this milky non-milky agitation getting so big? Now, this committee submitted its report and it said that it was politically motivated. The students and the police also should have exercised some restraint and all these things. The subcommittee submitted its report to the government. Now, the reason why we say that 1952 agitation is successful is because it at least could achieve its mandate. Its mandate was to have a subcommittee appointed. It achieved it. The second reason why 1952 agitation was important is for the first time, the voice was loud and clear about the Mulki domination. And the slogan was non-Mulki go back, Idli Sambar go back. Why do we say Idli Jagan Mohan Reddy committee? Thank you, Kaushik. It was in the flow. I could not get it. Now, why did we say that non-Mulki go back, Idli Sambar go back? Because Andhra region was a part of Madras state initially. Okay, so you know that is the reason we used Idli Sambar go back, non-Mulkis go back. Now, the second reason why 1952 agitation is very, very important is because 1952 agitation marked the beginning of students' role in the agitation for formation of Telangana. Right from 1952 to the last agitation for the formation of Telangana, students played a very, very important role. 1952 agitation was totally driven, initiated, driven by the students. That is another reason why it became very important. And 1952 agitation also highlighted the domination of the non-Mulkis in Hyderabad state. Hyderabad state, where we had our own CM, where you know we had our own state. We were not yet integrated with Vishalandhra, but still we had there was domination of non-Mulkis. So this is the whole scenario. Now, how do you write the answer? Please remember, you have to mention the dates related to the deadline given by the student JSE. You have to remember the name of the leader. The name of the leader was Buchaya. Okay, the leader of the JSE. The name of the DEO. The name of the teacher who passed away. The name of the police commissioner, city police commissioner. The name of the chief minister, Durgula Ramakrishna was the chief minister then of Hyderabad state. Then you have to remember the City College incident, the date related to City College incident, Pingali Jagan Mohan Reddy committee, when was it appointed, what was its concluding remarks. Now, the flow of the answer should be, you should first start with, by 1952, the non-Mulki domination within the administration was prevalent, and an incident that exposed the domination of non-Mulkis led to the beginning of the agitation. Now, the incident, you have to write about Partha Sarathi transferring the teachers. Then you have to write about how students came together, formed a group, met the CM, gave him a deadline, posed the deadline, how the police lathi charge began, and from there, how it spread to Hyderabad. This part should come in the next part. The next should be the City College incident in a very small para, followed by the appointment of Pingali Jagan Mohan Reddy committee. In conclusion, you can write about the importance of the 1952 agitation. As I said, 3 points. One is 1952 agitation was the first major agitation against the non-Mulkis in Telangana region. The whole agitation, the course of events during the agitation exposed the dominance of the non-Mulkis within the system, within the government. The second is 1952 agitation to a large extent was successful because what was the demand of the agitation was fulfilled. The third reason why it is important is it marked the beginning of student action for a separate Telangana state. Students started fighting for separate Telangana with the 1952 agitation, of which Professor Jayashankar was a part as a student. Okay, and it continued till Telangana was formed. So, you know, 1952 agitation gave a lot of confidence to the students to start the agitation. In 1969 also, they played a role. The whole course till formation of Telangana, they played an important role. So this is about the 1952 agitation. Any questions that you would like to ask me? I'm open for the questions. Next Saturday again, I'll schedule another Insta live with you where I'm going to share two more questions. This time probably I'll take a question on society and I'll take a question on governance, because these are areas where students are usually facing a lot of problem. Anand, the maximum marks will be 5 to 6 out of 10. Maximum will be 6, 6.5. I don't see them going beyond that. 6.5 should be the maximum. Any more questions? Are the sessions usual? Subcommittee and members, Raj, if you write all those details, don't you think your answer will become too big? I hope these sessions are useful. This way I'm going to discuss two questions every week. See, ultimately, you have to wind off your words in 250 words, Raj. Otherwise, you won't be able to complete the paper. Answer ఎంత బాగా రాస్తున్నామన్నది దానికంటే ఆన్సర్స్ మొత్తం అన్ని క్వశ్చన్స్ కంప్లీట్ చేశామా లేదా చాలా ఇంపార్టెంట్. లేకపోతే చాలా ప్రాబ్లం అవుతుంది మీకు. సో ప్లీజ్ కీప్ దిస్ ఇన్ మైండ్, ఎన్ష్యూర్ దట్ యు ఆర్ ఏబుల్ టు కంప్లీట్ ద హోల్ పేపర్. నేను మీకు ఇంకొక చిన్న సజెషన్ ఇస్తాను. ఐ హోప్ యుల్ టేక్ ఇట్ సీరియస్లీ. ద సజెషన్ ఇస్, నేను ఇప్పుడు 2 2 క్వశ్చన్స్ డిస్కస్ చేస్తున్నా. ఈ రోజు డిస్కస్ చేసిన క్వశ్చన్స్ ప్లీజ్ ట్రై అండ్ రైట్ దెమ్. So you have the question with you, I told you the structure. Try to frame the answer and write it. This way you will start practicing answer writing. You'll also know how much time you would get. Anand, in English it is very difficult. Moment aithe Prakash sir book okate undi, inke edi ledu. I would not recommend anything because that is the only standard book that you have. Telangana history, you have to go for Telugu Academy. There is no book. And Telangana economy, I would request you to read the socio-economic survey of Telangana. English medium aithe ide. Any more questions? Next week, I will not have it at 6 o'clock. I'm going to schedule it at 5. And from here on, we are going to schedule the class at 5. The Insta live at 5 every Saturday. And this is where you can interact with me. I'll be live. If you have any queries with respect to your preparation and all, please feel free to ask me. And next week's question, I'll ensure that I post them by Thursday. All right. So I'll see you again next Saturday. All right. Thank you and bye-bye.